for diurnally varying hydration, well, hydrogen really, at the moon's equator from using the LEND instrument on LRO, our large cast of characters that listed at the bottom. We shall all be known by our acronyms for our institution. Let's just see, by their acronyms shall they be known. All right, so this is motivated by work that was actually published, not by my involvement, although I have stuck myself on this slide for a reason. But this was all published about the time that LRO actually reached station at the moon and entered its mapping orbit. There were three publications in Science showing water of hydration, or OH of hydration, really, but mineral hydration seen on the moon at low latitude. And in particular, close to my heart, because I was working on the epoxy mission at the time, Jessica Sunshine showed from epoxy data that was actually collected as calibration measurements that not only did we see mineral hydration on the moon at low latitude, but in fact it increased over at the terminator. At the time, the observation that she's showing here, ooh, I don't have a pointer, the observation that she was showing in the image on the right is actually from a high northern latitude. So the North Pole is, I will step over and show you, about there. Ah, you have the pointer. But I'm all done. But I'm all done. Anyway, thank you. So we were looking over the pole to see the dusk terminator also. On the left, what we've got is, this is from a paper we published in Astrobiology in 2011, where we have the measured spectrum of the moon seen actually in the situation that you see down there in the little pretty picture of the Earth. This is an actual picture of the moon seen transiting the Earth from epoxy. This is not a simulation. We're very proud of that. And there's also, I made a simple model of that. If you divide out the simple model, you see this hydration feature, which is more or less the feature that, with similar analysis that Jessica used for mapping the hydration all over the moon there. So what we wanted to look at is how much water is actually there. So there are actually three instruments, as I mentioned, that detected this mineral hydration. There was, of course, the epoxy high-resolution instrument infrared spectrometer. There was the M-cubed instrument in Chandrayaan-1. And also going back in time, in a retrospective analysis of Cassini-VIMS data, Roger Clark showed that you could also see it in data from a Cassini flyby of the Earth-Moon system. But we don't know how much water is actually there, because technically you can only see about half a wavelength into the surface of whatever monolayer you might be seeing. So we could be, everything could be in the top 1.4 micron of the surface, because it was all seen with 2.8 micron light. So we'd like to know more about that. Our instrument, LEND, is a neutron detector, and it's intended to probe into the surface. So as Rich mentioned earlier, he described the methodology, so that saves me some time. He also noted that it is a relatively low signal-to-noise process. You have to collect a lot of data, and statistics are an issue. We are not one of those instruments that gets signal-to-noise of thousands within seconds, by several orders of magnitude. So what we'll do here is we'll look exclusively at LEND data that was collected at low latitude. We're in a polar orbit, so we visit low latitudes every orbit, discriminated by the local time of the observation. So here's an that was supposed to be animated. So anyway, I'll have to do this by hand. Since we're in a polar orbit, this is looking down from, pick a pole, let's go with the North Pole. Actually, it is the North Pole. So at a time when our orbit would be over the dawn-dusk terminator line, as time goes on through the year, our orbit then precesses, well, it doesn't really precess, rather the moon changes beneath us, so that our time then moves to earlier and earlier times in the morning on one side and earlier and earlier in the afternoon on the other side, but we are symmetric, so we go all the way around. So whenever we make a measurement all of our measurements are made 12 hours in local time apart, is the critical thing. So I can see that none of my cute animations are going to come through, so this will be fun. Okay, just to give an idea of what our instrument looks like, I always feel you should see the actual instrument at some time. This is the LEND instrument prior to integration on the spacecraft. We have this pretty sort of ziggurat in the middle here. And this little canister over here is our uncollimated epithermal neutron detector. We have collimated detectors that are down inside there. Let's see. Okay, so I will have to tell you what you would have seen if there were a if the animation were there, which is just to show you that there are four detectors down in the base of this collimator that look up through these barrels that were intended to make collimated measurements of the moon with relatively high spatial resolution to map the polar regions. And while that was the intention, that's not the way I'm using it. What we actually see is, well, we see a population of neutrons that do make it down those barrels, but we also see neutrons that make it through the walls, and they are born with higher energy from the surface of the moon because otherwise they would not have made it through the walls of the collimator. And so by using the detectors that are down in here and using this uncollimated detector that we have here that is just viewing the moon through a cadmium foil that limits it to epithermal neutrons, we have two different energy populations available to us, even though it was somewhat unintentional. There are, of course, efforts going into how to separate the collimated in epithermals from the not-so-collimated outside field of view higher energy ones, but that's not relevant for this particular purpose. I don't even actually need to distinguish exactly what the relative fractions are, although I have a poster on that that you can come visit, 34A, if I recall correctly. All right, so Rich has already talked about how you get suppression of epithermal neutrons as you increase the hydrogen content in the regolith, you suppress the epithermal neutrons, you get a more and more suppressed signal. Of course, it's not actually making these neutrons disappear from existence. All it's doing is scattering them so efficiently that their energy is reduced into the thermal range, so they're simply no longer detectable through the foil that we use on the detector. Right, here are maps of the actual, ooh, the orange doesn't come through well, but here are maps of what's actually seen with our two different detectors. This is our uncollimated detector, or SETIN, as we call it. And here is our collimated detector, or CSETIN. They do look different, and that's because of the different energy populations that are seen by each of these detectors. So this is a higher energy population in general, and we're not going to worry about comparing, but this happens to resemble a fast neutron map more when we look at the whole globe of the moon. Let's see, we'll just move forward. Yep, no animations at all. So at any given latitude and longitude position on the moon, the measurement that we accumulate over time, and the data that I'm showing you here was actually accumulated over 2.3 years, so at any given latitude and longitude position, the measurements were acquired at many different local times. There is no significance to the actual clock settings on here except that they're all different. So any given measurement may have been acquired at dawn, at dusk, at noon, at midnight, anywhere in between. But if we want to break it up by local time, then what we find is that for any given local time, so a specific local time value, that would be, you know, attached to a given latitude, that would have been acquired at many different longitudes. And as you can see, there is a variation in the signal with latitude and longitude positions. So we would have an intrinsically varying signal in which we want to look at an additional variation that is created by a local time effect. So what we do is use the methods of traditional, plain old-fashioned astronomy and flat field our measurements. We use the map. And at each latitude, longitude position, for every individual measurement as it comes in, we divide it out by the intensity of the map at that position. Now, technically, that means that every point is being divided by its own measurement, diluted by a lot of other measurements. This can only really work if there really are a lot of other measurements. And that's the benefit, having gone through 2.3 years, as I say, we've seen almost five complete turns of the insolation pattern underneath the spacecraft orbit. Of course, the orbit is only a little less than 2 hours long, so we've actually visited those points many, many times over the course of the lunar day and seen it go by slowly. So we actually have a fairly good dilution on that. And of course, fairly good will pretty much be defined by whether we're actually able to get a result. By dividing each one of those measurements out by its nominal intensity at that latitude and longitude position, we then have something where the only intrinsic variability left is the local time component. So we can add them all up to one specific local time that goes to that latitude and that local time measurement. Okay, so this is actually a map of our uncollimated detector signal in local time versus latitude. I've got it binned in 20 degree latitude bins and smoothed in the local time direction just because there's a limit to how much you can pick out with your eye without smoothing it. So the actual smooth data is not used for analysis, it's just used for nice pictures. What we see here is where it's dark, we have suppression of neutron emission. Where it's bright, we have, well, it's not an enhancement, rather it's the unsuppressed signal. And so you can see we're brightest in the late afternoon towards dusk. We're darkest near dawn. I've heard that phrase before. At this point, we're just going to restrict ourselves to this range in low latitude. Now, this is the actual signal that you see, or whatever amount of hydrogen that would be in the surface would be related to the inverse of that last map. So I've just inverted it for your benefit. So you can see it's nice and bright here at dawn. Any variation in latitude that you see here is something that I'm not prepared to stake anything on at this point, but obviously that's something that we would want to be investigating. And what we'll do is restrict ourselves to this range of plus or minus 30 degrees latitude, picked somewhat arbitrarily because it simply means that we're not looking at a terribly significant difference in insolation as a function of latitude. Okay, so I've done this now for our two different detectors. So this is our uncollimated detector that we see up here, where I've organized the signal that we see by local time. This is our collimated detector, the one that sees a higher energy population of neutrons that is also organized by local time. What you're seeing in the background here, the nice little colored bars here represent the signal in 2 hour wide bins of local time. So that's actually significantly more than 2 Earth hours. With an uncertainty estimate. There's some debate on how to do the uncertainty estimate, and I decided I didn't want to get bogged down in that. So I have gone with the most conservative, least friendly to me possible way of estimating uncertainties, which is to go back to good old-fashioned population uncertainties. I've actually taken the signal and broken it down into bins of 5 minutes of local time. So signal to noise in each individual measurement is terrible. But it gives me a population of 25 measurements across each one of these two-hour bins that I can then use to compute standard error of the mean and the mean. And just to verify that I'm not being skewed by still a relatively small population, I'm only using the five-minute bins to show it to you because it keeps it from being a horrible cloud on here. I've actually done the calculations with one-minute bins that have 121 individual measurements across each of these, and they get exactly the same standard error of the mean and mean value. So that indicates that we've gone deep enough on that. As you can see, the contrast is much shallower on the uncollimated detector than on the collimated detector. But because the error bars also scale with that, they're actually both about the same significance. So comparing, actually using these three measurements as a reference for a not necessarily dry, but the driest, the least hydrated regolith we have, there's about 5.7 sigma between those two. And similarly, if I average these three of the least suppressed and compared to that one, there's about 5.7 there. So we have our most neutron suppression just after dawn. If we put that in a polar projection, this is for our uncollimated detector. So here's our most suppressed signal is over here in the afternoon and moving into dusk. Our signal comes up over the evening. And at dawn, we have our greatest suppression is right here. It then falls off during the course of the day back down to that minimum in the afternoon. So this is the uncollimated detector. And then with the higher energy neutron population seen by the collimated detector, we see something similar but with greater contrast. Okay, so what could give us a pattern like that? Well, so here's our Here are those again, smaller. If you imagine any poor defenseless little volatile molecule that finds itself somewhere on the lunar surface, it will tend to migrate from the warm lunar surface towards, I adopt Rick Elphick's term from yesterday, the temporary cold trap of the night side of the moon, where the temperatures drop sharply down to about 120 over here to 100 Kelvin over here at dawn, and get stuck. So if you look at a molecule that gets stuck to the surface here at dusk, it's carried through the lunar night by rotation. It meets the migrating molecules from the dawn side, and as it moves into daylight, it's liberated from the surface, revolatilized as the surface warms up, and migrates back across. So you get this cloud. And this is not a fresh model with me, although I felt proud of it when I thought of it myself and then discovered that it's all through the literature already. It's a very depressing moment, that. So here's an example, though, of when it was measured before. And once again, okay, so I got it. Am I completely dead? All right. Okay, then. So you can come ask me questions afterwards, since I've used up somebody else's time, too. That's it.
Thank you.